It's said that one's devotion to a right to freedom of speech is measured by one's willingness to apply it to the views one most disagrees with. This follows the motto, "I disagree with what you say, but I will fight to my death your right to say it." To illustrate his arguments, Mill sought to apply them to what was regarded at the time the most clearly false and pernicious belief he could think of. Mill wrote, quote, "In order more fully to illustrate the mischief of denying a hearing to opinions because we, in our judgment, have condemned them, it will be desirable to fix down the discussion to a concrete case, and I choose, by preference, the cases which are least favorable to me, in which the argument against freedom of opinion, both on the score of truth and on that of utility, is considered the strongest." End quote. The belief that Mill chose as the most pernicious and false was the belief that there's no God. Mill wrote, quote, "Let the opinions impugned be the belief in a God and in a future state, or any of the commonly received doctrines of morality." End quote. The belief in a God and in an afterlife being considered here so certain, no reasonable person can deny it. Among these, we may count the view that a belief in a God is necessary, a belief in an afterlife, and in particular, the fear of eternal punishment for evils done in this world are considered necessary to preserve the good order of society. If the right to freedom of speech to those denying the existence of a God and divine retribution could be justified, then it can be applied to anything. To understand Mill's argument, we must keep in mind that Mill was acting on utilitarian principles. So for Mill, to make his case, he'd have to argue that a rule that prohibited the punishment of those who denied the existence of such a God would be good for society. Against this, one can argue that it seems implausible that society may not protect itself from those who would attempt to persuade people to give up beliefs on which the good order of society is thought to depend. Here we're going to look at five of the arguments that Mill offers in defense of his thesis. I'm going to label these first, understanding. This is the idea that you do not fully understand a position unless and until you understand the arguments that might be used against it and can defend it from those objections. The next argument to consider, that of dead dogma, the view that a position that can't be challenged becomes a set of empty slogans rather than a part of how we live our lives. The third argument is that of vulnerability. If people are not practiced in defending their view from objections, then they will be vulnerable to weak arguments. The fourth argument is the problem of timid minds. If people are being punished for questioning a belief, there will be timid people worried that they may cross a fuzzy and uncertain boundary and thus shy away from investigating important subjects. And argument number five, responsibility. A person isn't justified in acting on a belief that has a serious impact on others unless and until they have considered everything that can be said against it. So let's start with the understanding argument. If the cultivation of the understanding consists in one thing more than in another, it is surely in learning the grounds of one's opinions. Whatever people believe, on subjects on which it is of the first importance to believe rightly, they ought to be able to defend against at least the common objections. End quote. A full understanding of any position must include an understanding of what can be said against it and the reasons why those objections are mistaken. Take, for example, the right to freedom of speech itself. Mill would say that you do not understand this subject, you don't understand the right of freedom of speech, unless you are aware of the strongest arguments against such a right and are capable of responding to those objections. I have to say, much of this course is premised on the assumption that this at least is true. You'll demonstrate your understanding of the issues you will be tested on by displaying your understanding of the best that can be said against your favored position. This means a freedom to present and discuss those strongest possible objections. Mill further went on to say the following. In the case of any person whose judgment is really deserving of confidence, how has it become so? Because he has kept his mind open to criticism of his opinions and conduct. Because it has been his practice to listen to all that could be said against him, to profit by as much of it as was just, and expound to himself and upon occasion to others the fallacy of what was fallacious. Because he has felt that the only way in which a human being can make some approach to knowing the whole of a subject is by hearing what can be said about it by persons of every variety of opinion, and studying all modes in which it can be looked at by every character of mind. No wise man ever acquired his wisdom in any mode but this, nor is it in the nature of human intellect to become wise in any other manner." End quote. Similarly, a law that prevented people from questioning, for example, our test case, the existence of God and of divine punishment, one doesn't understand even what it means unless people are allowed to raise questions about the nature of God and of divine punishment. What exactly would God punish or reward in the afterlife? Why would God punish one thing and not another? What type of punishment, if any, can be made compatible with God's virtue? The understanding objection is related quite closely to the dead dogma objection. If a view is not actively being investigated, then its principles cease to become an active part of one's life and becomes mere slogans, according to Mill. Here, Mill writes the following, quote, "However unwillingly, a person who has a strong opinion may admit the possibility that his opinion may be false, he ought to be moved by the consideration that, however true it may be, if it is not fully, frequently, and fearlessly discussed, it will be held as a dead dogma, not a living truth." End quote. Mill gives what he takes to be an example of this, the dead dogma that was in his time the teachings of Christianity. Mill wrote, quote, "To what an extent doctrines intrinsically fitted to make the deepest impression upon the mind may remain in it as dead beliefs without being ever realized in the imagination, the feelings, or the understanding is exemplified by the manner in which the majority of believers hold the doctrines of Christianity." End quote. And in this, Mill gives examples of claims that most Christians would hold to be true, according to their doctrine. The blessed are the poor and the humble. It is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Judge not, lest they be judged. Love your neighbor as yourself. And yet of these, Mill writes, quote, "Not one Christian in 1,000 guides or tests his individual conduct by reference to these laws," end quote. Okay, the third argument listed against prohibiting people from raising questions against the existence of a God or of divine punishment, or raising questions against any belief, is that a ban on expressing objections leaves people vulnerable to weak arguments. On this, Mill says, quote, "To shut out discussion entirely is seldom possible. And when it once gets in, beliefs not grounded on conviction are apt to give way before the slightest semblance of an argument," end quote. Censorship is never 100% successful. Somewhere or another, an idea is going to leak out and spread. And if people aren't practiced in defending their true and important beliefs from objections, their capacity to do so will weaken, creating a risk that a weak objection will take hold before it can be silenced. Think of it as running drills or practices, like the fire department or a military unit, which keeps the mind ready to defend a true and important belief from challengers when they appear. Argument number four was the problem of timid minds. Mill writes, quote, "The greatest harm done by threatening to punish those who express certain beliefs, such as heresies, is to those who are not heretics and whose whole mental development is cramped and their reason cowed by the fear of heresy. Who can compute what the world loses in the multitude of promising intellects combined with timid characters who dare not follow out any bold, vigorous, independent train of thought, lest it should land them in something which would admit to being considered irreligious or immoral?" End quote. By this, for example, let's say somebody wants to investigate questions about how divine punishment can be compatible with divine foreknowledge. After all, if God has perfect foreknowledge and God knew that the individual was going to rob a bank, in fact, when God created the world, since God knows everything, God would know that he was creating a world in which that individual was going to rob a bank. How is this compatible with God punishing that individual to hell for robbing the bank? Timid minds have reasons to worry that such an investigation might be considered as a heresy, punishable by death. So instead, they become a baker and leave the thinking to others. Mill goes on to say, quote, "Where there is a tacit convention that principles are not to be disputed, where the discussion of the greatest questions which can occupy humanity is considered to be closed, We cannot hope to find that generally high scale of mental activity which has made some periods of history so remarkable. End quote. Now, the fifth of the arguments that Mill mentions is that of responsibility. When one's actions have an impact on others, one owes it to those others to carefully consider the actions from all sides. In this light, Mill mentions the practice of calling on a devil's advocate when deciding whether to canonize somebody. Mill writes, quote, "The Roman Catholic Church, even at the canonization of a saint, admits and listens patiently to a devil's advocate. The holiest of men, it appears, cannot be admitted to posthumous honors until all that the devil could say against him is known and weighed." End quote. By this principle, if you're going to assert an opinion on abortion or minimum wage or drug or gun prohibitions or any matter that will have an impact on the lives of others, you have an obligation to consider all that can be said against your position. A far more common example of this idea being put into practice in the current system is the right to a trial by jury. Imagine saying to the accused, "We are so certain that you are guilty that there's no need for a trial. We will simply convict you on the basis of what we currently know. You may not speak in your defense, nor may you have an advocate prepare a defense for you." Or to extend the analogy, we can imagine taking the argument a little bit further and saying to the accused, "Since you're obviously guilty, to allow somebody to speak in your defense would risk thwarting justice. Since the advocate who speaks for you may turn out to be capable of convincing some of us that you're not guilty, in which case we would suffer the consequence of a guilty person going unpunished." Here, I'd like to note that this isn't so much talking about a right to freedom of speech, but of an obligation to listen. In both the case of the devil's advocate and the rights of the accused, we're not talking about the importance of letting the accused speak so much, as we're requiring those in a position to act to seek out and consider what the other person can say in their defense. More practical matters, it implies that in holding any position on any policy matter that has an influence on the lives of others, individuals who advance or promote a policy have an obligation to seek out what others might say against their position. But of course, an obligation to seek out what others might say against a position requires that others have a right to say things against that position. Now, before closing, I'm going to bring up another argument that doesn't come from Mill, but has been mentioned recently. It's something that's been noticed in countries that ban, for example, Holocaust denial. In some parts of the world, it's illegal, punishable by imprisonment, to argue that the Holocaust never took place. One of the effects of this type of censorship seems to be that it causes some people to ask, what's the government trying to hide? Why are they trying to find these people and shut them up? What don't they want us to know? And of course, the fact that Holocaust denial is criminalized means that one can't try to do research to find out what the government is trying to hide, allowing the imagination to run wild. Such censorship may give people a reason to believe that which there is no reason to believe. They can't trust that they have an understanding of an issue where people expressing views on the matter are forced into silence. These, then, are Mill's arguments for saying that even if a position is false and pernicious, as the denial of a god in an afterlife where wrongdoers will be punished may be, a rule threatening to harm those who express that idea will itself do more harm than good. It'll prevent people from more fully understanding the truth. It will leave the truth a dead dogma rather than a living doctrine. It will weaken the minds of those who object to it. It will make timid minds fearful of investigating the boundaries of the truth. And it will make actions based on the view illegitimate, since agents can't fulfill their obligation to consider all that can be said against an action that may affect others. Mill said, as mentioned above, that we do not understand a position unless we understand all that can be said against it. Well, this video has presented Mill's theory. Further videos will consider what can be said against it.